And thank you everybody for coming. My name is Teresa O'Keefe. I'm on the faculty of the Clough School of Theology and Ministry at Boston College, and thrilled to see so many familiar faces in the Zoom room here. And really happy to be facilitating this session of Pedagogies for Spiritual Leadership. Two papers, just to give you a sense of our time together, two papers were submitted, both of which attend to that topic, but we'll actually have three presentations as part of it. First, we're going to hear from Wanda Stahl on her work, Meaningful Vocation in a Climate Changed World, Learnings from the Seminary of the Wild. After she speaks, I'm going to give everyone a moment to write a note to themselves, share their thought with themselves, and then we will move to the second presentation based on the paper by Orla O'Reilly Hazra. That one is entitled Religious Education in the Context of an Evolutionary Universe, a Deeptime Mythopoetic Approach. And she will present with Jennifer Morgan. So that's where you'll have two presentations, where Jennifer will be talking about the Deeptime. And after a short pause of that one, give you a chance to collect your own thoughts. Then I'm going to invite Wanda to respond to Orla's paper, and then Orla to respond to Wanda before opening the floor up to whomever has a thought to share. All right, so that's the plan of our time together until 1 o'clock. So let me introduce Wanda Stahl. So Reverend Dr. Wanda Stahl is a spiritual guide, a retreat leader, an educator, and a consultant who has worked in a variety of congregational, denominational, and academic settings. She served as the Director of Contextual Education and Clinical Assistant Professor of Contextual Theology and Practice at Boston University School of Theology until her recent retirement in 2022. Wanda continues at BU as an adjunct faculty and on the leadership team for Creative Callings, which is a Lilly-funded project focusing on supporting local congregations in discerning and deepening their communal vocations. She's also the program consultant for the BTS Center and an organization committed to nurturing spiritual leadership in a climate change world. And she's the program chair for this conference. So thank you, Wanda. And turning the floor over to you.
Thank you so much, Teresa, for that lovely introduction. I'm going to share my screen here. And welcome to this conversation focused on this paper of Meaningful Vocation in a Climate Changed World, Learning from Seminary of the Wild. I can get the play button to show up. I will put it in a better mode for viewing. My computer is okay. We'll just go with it. Here we go. So my interest in this project was sparked by research that I conducted in 2018 and 2019 on wild churches in the United States. Those interviews identified transformation in people's relationship with the more than human world as a result of their participation in wild churches. However, that project provided just a snapshot of a moment in time, rather than reliable information on what might facilitate and sustain such changes over time. In 2020 and 2021, the opportunity to take part as a participant observer in the first cohort of the Seminary of the Wild Eco-Ministry Certification Program offered me an opportunity to witness and document changes in people over time, especially given this program's focus on spiritual leaders. Okay, I'm having some issues here. I'm sorry. We'll make it work. Here we go. Seminary of the Wild proposed to nurture deep authenticity and foster leadership development through engagement with the more than human world, to help participants remember their deep participation in sacred earth, to engage with an ancient and yet new way of relating with the earth, with other humans, and with God, defined by a deep interconnection between all things. This transformation sought by Seminary of the Wild is analogous to what in other contexts has been described as ecological conversion or shifts in consciousness. For example, in their book, Active Hope, Joanna Macy and Chris Johnstone write about the need for shifts in consciousness alongside outward action to bring about what they call the Great Turning, which they define as a transition from a doomed economy of industrial growth to a life-sustaining society committed to the recovery of the world. And they say, we take part in this shift in consciousness when we pay attention to the interfrontier of change, to personal and spiritual development that enhances our capacity and desire to act for our world. By strengthening our compassion, we give fuel to our courage and determination. By refreshing our sense of belonging in the world, we widen the web of relationships that nourishes us and protects us from burnout. So my paper explored and highlighted changes in participants' understanding and practice of vocation that was sparked by shifts in consciousness as a result of their participation in Seminary of the Wild. So just an idea of the components of Seminary of the Wild. The program included 4 intensive online modules with the following themes: Wild Self, Wild Earth, Wild Christ, and Wild Call. Each online intensive included time for content sharing related to that module's theme, shared ritual, small group conversation, and off-screen individual reflective practices in the natural world. In between these intensive sessions, participants were offered online presentations by guest presenters, readings, journal prompts, and practices to engage. The practices generally fell into 3 categories. Wandering, which was an individual weekly time in the natural world for 30 to 60 minutes, often with a guiding question or a suggested practice. Imaginal journeys, a form of guided meditation which helped participants connect with deeper wisdom beyond conscious thought and reflection. Ceremony. Typically, at the conclusion of each module, participants were given a specific ritual to engage during an extended time in the natural world in order to synthesize their learnings and their experiences from that module. Each participant was also assigned to a monthly small group or clan, which was led by one of the 4 leaders of the program, and they also received individual mentoring from that guide. So I invited participants to complete a total of 5 surveys. There was a pre-program survey and a survey after each of the 4 online modules, actually after the conclusion of all the material from that module. So those who completed at least the pre-program survey and the final survey were invited to take part in follow-up interviews 6 months later. And I ended up with 12 of the 25 participants who agreed to be interviewed out of 14 who qualified, made those criteria. The interviews sought to ascertain what formational learnings had been sustained over the 6 months since completion of the program and which aspects of the program, if any, had been most personally and vocationally significant. And there's just a note there about the participant demographics, North America, equal number of male and female, 5 clergy out of the 12, and all identifying as white. While participants mentioned a number of texts assigned during the Seminary of the Wild as formative, there were 2 texts that consistently provided shared language and principles for program participants. My paper goes into more detail about these texts, but I'm going to highlight their key points here as they're helpful in helping us understand the interview data. The primary text for the first module on Wild Self was Bill Plotkin's book, Wild Mind, A Field Guide to the Human Psyche. Plotkin lays out a map for shifting consciousness undergirded by 2 foundations. The first is the cultivation of wholeness, which he contrasts with most of Western psychology's primary emphasis on treating pathology. He asserts that focusing on pathology rather than on possibility and participation has unintentionally cramped our abilities to grow whole and to fully mature. The second foundation that Plotkin identifies is direct connection to the more than human world as a primary guide and teacher. What might happen, he asks, When we allow nature to be the primary therapist or guide, while the human mentor or advisor becomes more of an assistant to nature, an agent or handmaiden of the wild. This role of nature as primary guide was emphasized and practiced in Seminary of the Wild. The Genius Myth by Michael Mead was a key text in the Wild Call module, and this emphasized the giftedness of each human being, or what Mead describes as a person's genius. In Mead's understanding, genius imagines that everyone is subject to a genuine calling in life. The question becomes, in what way does genius appear in you, and how might it contribute to both your own well-being and that of the world around you? Our genius calls upon us to awaken to the precise ways that we might help heal the wounds of history and contribute to the reweaving of nature and culture. So these themes of cultivating wholeness, acting out of authenticity, and utilizing one unique gifts for the healing of the world emerge consistently in the Seminary of the Wild interviews. So I'm gonna go back for just a second. So I began each interview by reading back participants' responses to two questions from the final Seminary of the Wild survey, and then asked if their responses still held true. One question asked respondents to describe new ways of believing, being, and doing that they had gleaned from the program. And the second asked them to describe life changes and growing edges that had developed from their participation. Most every respondent indicated that their answers from 6 months previously still held true. And their responses highlight a number of shifts in consciousness. The first one we'll mention is the ability to just stay present. So Laura, a lay person involved in Wild Church leadership, stated the following: I often felt overwhelmed by the immensity of the task in front of us to heal the planet and despair for future generations. I find that the program has given me a new perspective, tools for the journey. And while the problems we face are still the same, I have peace and steadiness within, allowing me to take one day at a time and commit to doing the best I can in that day. Cliff explicitly stated his intention to nurture my own wholeness and engage more fully in the world in his final survey. In our interview, he shared, I tend to disengage from the world when things get chaotic or troublesome. And I think I've intentionally decided to not turn away from that kind of stuff and just be more present with my feelings and also with other people. I just feel that I'm living life as it comes and engaging in it more fully than turning away. People also described renewed or deepening sense of call. And these shifts in call were often described in terms of living deeper into authenticity or bringing a new way of being into work that they were already doing. Lorraine stated, I just feel so clearly in myself that I finally landed in the work that I'm supposed to be doing, both for myself and for the world. And I don't think I've ever walked fully in that kind of confidence before, that I'm truly authentically living into my call. Charles described a shift in his anti-racism work. As a white man who has a lot of resources, the question always is, what am I supposed to be doing? And maybe that's not the question. Maybe the question is, who am I supposed to be? And how am I supposed to be here? It's really about developing the capacity to hold space, to be present. So for me, there's a direct connection between the work I do in racism and simply trying to be present and listen and learn. Trying to simply be present in a different way, rather than maybe just as a guilty white guy. Several Seminary of the Wild participants were also counselors or therapists. Those that I interviewed described different practices that they were now incorporating into their work and or ways in which their renewed relationship with the more than human world positively impacted their energy and attention that they were able to give to their practice. Seminary of the Wild enabled some participants to claim new aspects of their identity. Pam was able to claim her identity as an artist. Prior to her experience of Seminary of the Wild, Pam dabbled in oil painting, but refused to say she was an artist. During the year-long Seminary of the Wild process, which happened to coincide with the first year of the COVID-19 pandemic, Pam described herself, using her words, painting like a madwoman for survival. At the time of our interview, a local art gallery had just accepted a number of her paintings for an exhibit. She stated, "Now I get to call myself an artist. That's my wild self saying, yes, you can do this. Not, no, you're not good enough. No one will ever look at your art and care about what you paint. And the recognition is nice, but I really don't do it for that. I did it because I wanted to create beauty in the world when it seemed like there wasn't anything but ugly." And at the time of our interview, Grant was working with Hero Masters in the Andes Mountains to become a Paco shaman, a combination of earthkeeper, mystic, and shaman, as he described it. He stated, "That's definitely something I've been interested in for about 15 years, but the experience of Seminary of the Wild really helped me to consider that and step into it." So what aspects of Seminary of the Wild were most significant in helping participants to make these shifts? While all the program components that I described previously were named by one or more of the interview participants, two were named by every interviewee in some way. And the first was deeper connection to the earth. All participants described the practice of wandering, which offered the opportunity to engage at least weekly with the more than human inhabitants of their ecosystems as kin, neighbors, and teachers, as an essential practice for deepening their connection to the earth. People describe significant encounters with trees, ants, bodies of water, and other beings, relationships that began during the Seminary of the Wild program and have continued. Cliff described his relationship with a tree that he calls his grandmother. "Whenever I'm walking through the cemetery, I walk up to her and give her a big hug. And it's more for my own well-being than what it feels like I'm offering to her. And she has a way of reminding me that everything in life will be just fine despite all the tumult and the chaos." Pam stated that "My connection with the earth was profound before, but I still felt separate. I cared for Mother Earth, but I didn't feel that I was an integrated part of nature. Now I'm much more aware of how I am a part of everything, and everything is a part of me." The second foundational practice was supportive community. Interview participants described the significance of their monthly plan meetings for sharing, accountability, and support. And 6 months out, I discovered that most participants have continued to meet with their clans or another configuration of Seminary of the Well participants. Julie described continuing these relationships as like life to me, life support. Her clan supported her to find my own way and then to come back and have it witnessed and held. There's a place to belong without having it have to be a certain way necessarily. There was so much room for you to be like, this is where I am, and to be held with so much love in that process. People named this ongoing support as essential to maintaining the shifts that had occurred as a result of participation in Seminary of the Wild. Charles describes the importance of continuing his monthly clan meetings. "Because we're checking in, and we're speaking of our journeys and our time on the land, and we're listening to one another and affirming one another. It's probably been the greatest gift in terms of continuing the Seminary of the Wild. It helps remind me of, oh wow, I have a meeting on Monday and I haven't been on the land, I'd better get out there." So what are some implications for education and formation in a climate change world? Participation in the Seminary of the Wild experience clearly assisted participants in discerning, affirming, and/or living more fully into their life's purpose. And authenticity. Angel. In the Christian tradition, for example, small communities were foundational in its early manifestation and continue in some contemporary Christian settings. Such groups have the potential to become places where people are supported in nurturing shifts of consciousness if they are properly facilitated to build trust and nurture open, honest sharing amongst participants and deeper connection with the natural world. Faith communities can also incorporate experiences of meaningful connection with the more than human world. Outdoor worship services, small groups with times for reflective wandering are possibilities for many communities. Providing opportunities for folks to pay attention to the natural world around them, even and perhaps maybe especially in urban settings, can foster deepening love and care for the more than human world. Naming wandering as a spiritual practice alongside prayer, meditation, and our study of sacred written texts can encourage individual faith community members to see the relationship with the more than human world as an essential part of their faith practice and spiritual development. In closing, I just want to name two fundamental challenges or obstacles that are present in many mainstream Western faith communities that could inhibit such shifts of consciousness. And these would really warrant further exploration beyond the scope of what I was able to do in this paper. First, faith communities need to recognize that this formation process is long-term. One program, one sermon series, one small group study will be insufficient in bringing about the shifts in consciousness needed to sustain one's being or work in planetary flourishing. The quick fix mentality of Western culture has conditioned an expectation that a weekend workshop or 8-week study can lead to significant change. Seminary of the Well participants recognized that the changes that they experienced during the process needed ongoing support to be sustained and for fostering continued growth. They recognized that 1 year was insufficient for changes to root deeply and continue to flourish. And then the second issue is theological. The undergirding principles of fostering wholeness and uncovering one's giftedness or genius sparked significant changes in Seminary of the Well participants. One can assume from this that strengthening emphasis on each person's value and worth as a beloved child of God and a recipient of God's grace could lead to similar empowerment. Like Western psychology, some faith communities overemphasize the sinfulness of human beings at the expense of affirming their giftedness. This can be disempowering, leaving individuals and communities feeling like they have little to offer for transformation and healing of the world. Now, obviously, Western individuals and faith communities have much to repent in our treatment of the more than human world, along with other systemic injustices. That said, such repentance needs to be accompanied by an equally strong, if not stronger, emphasis on the God-given gifts we have been given to bring about healing and wholeness for this planet. From this foundation, faith communities can encourage members to utilize their gifts and abilities for the alleviation of suffering and for imagining and living into a different future. So this discussion has described shifts in consciousness that are possible when attention is given to addressing the spiritual roots of the climate crisis. By creating educational and formational environments where shifts in consciousness can be fostered, faith communities can increase their likelihood of contributing to the great turning rather than being disempowered bystanders to the demise of our planetary home. Thank you for listening.
Okay. Thank you, Wanda. Terrific work. I invite everybody to take a moment and write a thought to themselves about something that they've heard, so we don't lose track of this when we listen to the second presentation. All right, now take a deep breath in. A long breath out. Because it's Friday, do that again. Right. And we'll move to the second set. Not really gonna set because there's two. I'm going to introduce Orla and Jennifer together, and then they can move from one to the next in their presentations. So Orla presented a submitted a paper, which there's a lot of commonality you'll see between Wanda's and Orla's and the work that's being presented here. So it's a really good pairing. So Orla O'Reilly Hazra is an immigrant of parents from Ireland. She currently lives in Sarasota, Florida, with her husband Sanat from Kolkata, India, and also with two box turtles. Her professions have been in community recreation, addiction counseling, spiritual direction, and religious education. She returned to school in 2001 to Fordham University for her master's in spirituality and spiritual direction, and then followed that to pursue a PhD in religious education, which she completed in 2009. She traces somatic and narrative ways of knowing and our collective awakening through the fourfold wisdom conversation of religion, science, indigenous people, and women in particular. She then spent 11 years in India applying this model of religious education at retreat and eco literacy centers, such as St. Xavier's College in Mumbai. Since 2013, she has served as a founding board member of the Deeptime Network. There, she's collaborated with Jennifer Morgan, putting flesh on the bones of this religious education model. Jennifer Morgan is the president and founder of the Deeptime Network, which is award-winning author, storyteller, and educator, inspired by the work of Teilhard de Chardin, Maria Montessori, Thomas Berry, and Brian Swim. Her universe story trilogy, which includes Born with a Bang, From Lava to Life, and Mammals Who Morph, are used in classrooms around the world and have received the Teacher's Choice Award, the Nautilus semifinalist, and highest ratings from the AAAS, and has received wide endorsement from people including Jane Goodall, Neil deGrasse Tyson, and astronaut Edgar Mitchell, Thomas Berry, and Brian Swin. So I invite Orla to tell us something about her paper, Religious Education in the Context of the Evolutionary Universe, a Deeptime Mythopoetic Approach.
Thank you very much, Teresa. And thank you, REA. I got my dissertation in 2009, and then I went to India. So I haven't kind of spoken to religious educators as a group since I left. So I'm really happy to be back. And I'm also so happy to see the changes that have been going on, because in 2009, although there were kind of people coming up through the cracks talking about the universe story and about Earth, it wasn't a focus. And so I'm really happy to see that it's changing. And so religious education in the context of an evolutionary universe, that was basically what my research was about, even though I didn't really know it was at the time I was doing my research. I was tracing the pattern of alienation, awakening, and connection, that somatic feeling of interiority and belonging. And then, of course, I had to make sense of that. And the only field that would allow me to do that was the field of religious education. So we've been talking about that we need a metanoia. And so basically, you know, we say we have a patriarchal hierarchy. So on the left, now hierarchy is an interesting term because it means holy order. It's not the hierarchy that's bad. It's the cosmology that is coming through this holy order. So of course, men were at the epitome, and creatures down below. So the shift, human focused, dualist, separate, the Cartesian cosmology in a mechanical and static movement. We didn't know about evolution until recently. So we have empire, kingdom, and denial of our interconnected nature. And so because of my license in addictions counseling, I'm really sensitive to that concept of denial. And I think it works in our in our community. So we need to move over now to a human-centered bound in a cosmogenesis, because we're not static, we're moving and expanding. So, and then being co-creative earth and an earth democracy, like Vandana Shiva calls for, kinship and a sense of reverence. So here we are, religious education, Gabriel Moran. He said, "The most comprehensive teacher is the whole universe, which offers gifts each day. The human can receive the gift of learning from ocean and desert, mountain and tree, sunlight and star, or the human being can refuse to be taught. Freedom is always a bounded situation." I love Moran's work because he plays with language. Now look at this paradox, freedom and being bound. A person exists with a physical body and a psychological makeup that are a precipitate of the past. So we're coming to understand that our psychological makeup is through a lens of dualism. And we have a physical body that's been kind of shaped with culturally with that. But we actually have a physical body that is interconnected with the rest of the cosmos and sensitive to chaos if we just pay attention to it. So Thomas Berry was a Passionist priest and taught at Fordham University before my time. And he called himself a geologian because he was honoring the earth and the cosmic community. So he said, in other words, we need to move the basic trend from the human to this larger context of things. And very often I come back to context because I worked with the Jesuits and was familiar with the Ignatian pedagogy, and they have context and then experience, reflection, action, and then evaluation. So the core movement of the spirit is experience, reflection, action. And then when they say see, judge, act, they're looking at the reflections on their experiences of, let's say, all the isms, the social injustice and climate change and alienation. Whereas in actuality, the context is tying them all together. There's a context that isn't being recognized. The issues aren't the context. It's reflecting on the experiences which are needed to be tend to and then tied back into the overall context. So Thomas Berry also suggested to have to restore and remember our interconnection, our sense of interconnection, he suggested a fourfold wisdom conversation of science, women, indigenous people, and religion, and a particular revelation that's coming as women come into critical hermeneutics with texts. And the rape of women, rape of the earth, from that same sense of separation. So what does the wisdom of science actually say? It says that in our body is the universe. So our bodies hold the story of 13.8 billion years history of evolution. Jennifer can give us a taste of that. And that is determined by this motion of cosmogenesis, an evolving universe. So let's say in biblical texts, we have a Genesis, and then everything starts off, and then it's kind of left to unravel on its own, where you know, in a never-ending state. Whereas cosmogenesis shows that it's open and expanding in space and time. So with that, we remember ourselves. We remember, it's an act of memory. And we remember that we're being drawn forth. We're being led towards some omega point, back to Teilhard. So then we look at educere, that's education. So here is how the universe is the primary educator. Sorry. So now we have the pedagogy of deep time leadership. So how do we establish a pedagogy that's based on deep time principle? So when I was over in India, and I knew Jennifer, and I would come back and we would go to these conferences of people teaching the story of science. And sometimes people, you know, some of them didn't want to discuss religion in conversation with science. And there just were some kind of, there were different camps and they weren't really talking to each other. So Jennifer came up with the idea of establishing an online platform to bring in these various communities that were teaching the story of science. And so I was involved with the Ignatian pedagogy, and we were wondering, well, what would be the principles then of deep time? And so let's just use Ignatian pedagogy because it's religious education. So we took the Ignatian pedagogy context, and then experience, we called matrix, experiencing relationality, which is differentiation. You'll see in the paper that these are the principles of cosmogenesis, differentiation, autopoiesis, and communion. And so we didn't want to use those words because they're too complicated. So we came up with matrix for experience, interiority, reflection, the autopoiesis. So this is the self-making that we do when we close our eyes and we get in balance and we follow our allurement and something happens. We heard from the playwright yesterday how he followed his allurement. He tapped into this well. And then action is action. But we're participating as a co-creative evolution with one another and the bioregion around us. And then the continuum. So we've been talking about hope sandwiches. So here we have a hope sandwich. Context is one slice and continuum, and then the ingredients there are cosmogenesis. So we can be in communion, munching away all day with cosmogenesis. So cosmology now, it's a two-sided dynamic of understanding and practice, back to Moran again, his two-sided model of education, understanding and practice. And in deep time, we pay attention to our interiority, which we culturally were not shaped to do. You know, when we come into these meetings, we come back and we center ourselves, whereas when we're outside, it's just out there. And then, you know, the four educational forms are family, school, work, and recreation, because our primary form of education for a child is the family. And unfortunately, education is locked into schools now. So, you know, all the social ills get put on the schools, whereas in actuality, it's the cosmology that needs to be healed. So then we need teachers as healers. So then back to Moran again, we have the languages in this conversation. And so he has three languages: the academic, the therapeutic, and the homiletic. And if you think back through the week, we've been hearing a lot of them. We've been hearing homiletic, where we have eco-preaching. But I want to pay attention to the first two on the left, because if you're calling people to do something, you're calling them to action based on an understanding, and the understanding isn't there, and it's just not there. And so we really have to pay attention to these first two, academic language and therapeutic. So with the fourfold wisdom conversation, you have the transdisciplinary, and you have, let's say with the sciences, you have physics, the birth of the universe, and then you have chemistry with the formation of the stars and galaxies, and then you have geology with the formation of the stars and planets, and then anthropology with the study of the human and everything along with human evolution. And then you have the modern industrial age, and you know, where are we now? So we're at a threshold moment now, a huge threshold moment. But if you think about cosmogenesis, you'll see that there have been threshold moments all through time. And then we have the therapeutic. So we've been experiencing a lot of grief and lament. And these are good. If you have grief and lament along with academic, it's good, because grief and lament without the understanding of the sense of interconnection, it's hard to hang on, and it's not reality.
Orla, I just want to let you know that you're bumping up into Jennifer's time now.
Okay, I'll be real fast. So I got a real mind opening with the indigenous research that I was doing. And this particular reflection that I heard from Viola Cordova was revelatory for me, because it wasn't how I was taught to discern. So she says, "My father described life as a constantly shifting sand. On that sand, I lay down a barrel. And on that barrel, I place a board. I maintain my balance by maintaining a certain harmony with the motion that I am reacting to. If violent action surrounds me, I maintain my stance, knowing that the action is only temporary. It is also that I examine my own actions as a possible source of such action. Have I even unknowingly contributed to the creation of violence? If there is ugliness around me, can I counter that with the creation of beauty?" So there she's balancing her interiority. So I'll just move on here. So deep time leadership and well-being. Here's a message for discernment. All human educational institutions, family, school, work, and recreation must now be judged primarily to the extent in which they inhibit, ignore, or foster a mutually enhancing human earth relationship. So now I'll pass it on to Jennifer, and Jennifer can share how we're doing it on the network.
Thank you, Orla.
Sorry, Jennifer.
Great, thanks. Thank you so much, Orla, and thank you so much, Wanda, for your paper and for your presentation. I want you or somebody else to do the same kind of study on our leadership program. Okay, so it's only really in the last 100 years that humans have discovered not only is life evolving, but also the entire cosmos is evolving. This is a radical new picture that is coming to us, and we're grappling with it. What does it mean? And as Thomas Berry says, we are between stories. The old ones don't work anymore, and we don't have a new one yet. But what this picture is showing us is this incredible, radical creativity of the universe to transform itself from plasma into, as Thomas Berry says, you know, into opera and into flowers and into giraffes and everything that we know. What does this mean? How do we need to entirely change our picture of what reality is and what the divine is? And as Wanda talked about so well, about nature as a primary guide in our paper, in her paper and talk, how's the cosmos, how's the universe also a primary guide? You know, we've got cosmos and Gaia as guides. So recontextualizing religious education inside of a universe that's transforming is just a huge step that we're taking, the threshold that we are crossing as humans. And so I'm going to just jump right into showing a video just to give you a little bit of a taste of what we're talking about. Okay, so let's go to my gosh, where is it? Yikes. I just had it. Here we go. Okay. Let me go back. Can everybody hear me?
We can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So what I'm going to show you, this has actually never happened to me before.
There you go. Now we can see your screen share.
Okay. Let me go. This is the strangest thing. I've never had this happen before.
Now we can't see your screen.
Yeah. I just stopped.
Okay. I think the tech gremlins are at it. My PowerPoint didn't work properly either. So,
gosh, I just have never had this happen. Let me just go here. Okay. Wait.
Now we can hear.
Okay. Okay. So you can hear me.
Yeah, can you hear me? You? Yes. I just okay. heard a little sound.
And can you see what I'm looking at?
Nope, not yet. So let's share that again.
Yeah, I'll share that again. Okay, here we go. All right. Okay, so we're going to go like this. All right, this is when the universe was 380,000 years old, and it's when hydrogen is forming. So you're going to see a picture of this in a minute. This image right here shows the WMAC Wilkinson Microwave Anisotropy Probe, and which light is coming to us every second. And so the WMAP Wilkinson Anisotropy Probe, they took the light and put it in slices such that you could look at cosmic evolution. So we're going to, in a minute, we're going to go on a video down the tunnel to the beginning of that image I just showed you when hydrogen was being formed. And then we're going to turn around and then we're going to come back to where we are right now. And just understand that on the right side, this is the most recent time. On the left side is the beginning of the universe. So we're going to go from current time with galaxies. We're going to go back through quasars. And we're going to go back through that time when hydrogen was forming. So you may, what I want you to do is just kind of relax into this moment and be looking at what's on the screen and also looking at what's happening within yourself as you're watching it. Like what is this bringing up within you? And then we'll just sit for 1 minute in silence afterward. And I don't think we have time now to talk a lot about it, at least at this moment. So then I'll just, after the silence, I'll go to the next things. Okay. So here's the, where we're going to go through that and then come back. Okay, here we go. Oh. Is that silence okay? Is that sound okay?
The sound is good. We're seeing a video. Now okay. We're not seeing anything.
Okay.
Now we're seeing your whole desktop.
Okay. Up share. And then we go share. And I've got to make sure the sound is okay.
The sound was good.
Okay.
Seeing your desktop again.
Right. Okay.
Now we're seeing the Earth. We're seeing images moving.
Okay.
And we're hearing sound. Great.
I hope that was a beautiful experience for all of you. And we can talk a little bit more about it later. It's always a little hard with these time constraints. So we are, I guess I'm past my time, aren't I? just to say that we have a Deeptime leadership program on the Deeptime network. We have had done it for 3 years. We have 176 people who have gone through all three modules of the 9-month program, and 56 are certified Deeptime leaders. It's been an incredible experience, and I was very touched by what Wanda was saying about the importance of small groups working and talking together over time. And we have found that it takes 9 months. It takes 9 months. And we've had people repeat the program actually 3 times, and they keep getting more out of the program each time. Brian Swim is going to teach a course in cosmogenesis starting in October on the Deeptime network. It'll be a 6-week course. And that also is going to be very powerful. We have many, many religious leaders in our programs. A lot of people from Asia, the Philippines in particular, sisters who are teaching this work in Vietnam and China and other countries in Asia and all over. So I'm very excited, and I'm excited to be here with you all. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Jennifer. Yeah, really profound, as people are responding in the chat there, profound communication. And thank you, Orla, for putting in the website for the Deeptime Network. It's helpful. So I'm going to give Wanda a chance to respond to Orla's paper. So spend just a couple of minutes, hopefully raising up one thing that you want to note. So Wanda.
Thank you. And thank you, Jennifer and Orla. That was quite amazing. Thanks for sharing your work. What struck me in reading your paper, in contrast to mine, is something that didn't come out specifically in mine, but Victoria Lores, who is one of the guides for the Seminary of the Wild, emphasizes the need to form a relationship with the particular being in order to then broaden and strengthen commitment and relationship with the wider world. You're starting kind of with the universe. You're starting as far out as you can get. So I'm wondering, and especially in light, you tell a story in the paper though, Orla, about your connection with an amoeba and how that was the start of the transformation for you. So I'm wondering, in this 9-month program, is there opportunity for folks to really dig in with relationships with particular beings? Is that part of what that experience includes?
Yeah, we have, because it's online, we encourage our students to, go outside. And so a lot of times people come back into the group and express, what they've been going through or what they're observing around them. And a lot of people, of course, have their pets. And so they're bringing their pets into the conversation because they know that their pets come from the same place that they do. That there's this evolutionary link that we're all related. And so there's that particular thing. So the distinction, I guess, between the two programs would be, the values and reverence and everything are the same. But for the deep time, it's trying to foster the sense of interconnection and potential and movement that each creature has. And as far as the amoeba experience, for me, that was a memory in a biology class of looking into a microscope and seeing this one cell creature, and we were learning the 7 characteristics of living things. feeding, breathing, movement, excretion, growth, reproduction, and sensitivity that that little amoeba has, all our cells have, the cosmos has these characteristics, and galaxies eat up other galaxies. So that memory, that sense of moving from, to, and towards became for me the kind of nugget then to bring back into the community through this religious education. That's what drove me into the field itself. And I'm sure that we all have these moments of aha, and they have a particular feeling, and they launch us off then into our study. Jennifer can give some more examples from our course and in the work she does with the Montessori schools, working with younger people. Yeah.
Right. So, all right, thank you, Orla. Now, Orla, I invite you to respond to something in Wanda's paper, hopefully something that you want to raise up.
Yes, Wanda, thank you so much for bringing out the work of Mead and Plotkin, and about the illness, the psychic illness, the spiritual illness, that it's not just Earth. I mean, we're separated. You know, we're in this state of denial, and I don't think that comes out very palpably in a lot of eco advocacy camps. You know, that we really are a little bit off, but we are remembering. I always call myself a Cartesian in recovery. So what struck me was the sense of call that people are experiencing, that sense of interiority and being called and finding a stream inside, that really struck me. And then the implications, and then the strength of that knowing, in the face of what we're up against, it gives community strength. And of course, we also have the community formation and pods and trying to carry on with that. And so I guess the question I was really glad to see about the return to traditions, you know, because we're all part of or have moved away from traditions, but they're there, and they have templates that we can reanimate with our memory. Like, you know, we reanimated the IPP by regrounding people in context, and you were reanimating the Methodist tradition. And so I'm wondering if you have some other examples of how people have gone back into their communities, either in a faith-based community, or taking that faith, that skeleton that needs to be animated in a quote unquote secular way. Because it seems to be like we're translators now. We're trying to take what's left and put flesh and bones through this new imagination.
Great question.
That is a great question. I'm trying to go through my brain about where some of those frameworks have landed. I think this isn't a faith tradition necessarily, but it was clear from the folks who were counselors or therapists that they were bringing that sense of wholeness and trying to encourage that giftedness back into their practices, as well as because they were coming out of their own places of having discovered their giftedness and wholeness through this process. And I think there was both folks who were appreciative of having some new frames with which to interpret the Christian tradition, going back to Jesus being outdoors, an outdoor teacher. Mm-hmm. as well as some folks are like, we've just got to throw this whole thing out and start somewhere else. There was a cohort of some of the mostly younger women in the program who really were really trying to go back to more of the goddess connection with Earth as sacred outside of the Christian framework. So it really opened, I guess I would say, opened a framework, an opportunity for people to do some deeper exploration and let go of frames that weren't working anymore, and then seek to discover some new ones that might be more grounding and relevant for them in their particular journey.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right. This has really been I've enjoyed starting with the two of you talking together, but I appreciate everybody took notes for themselves about something that they gained from one or both of the papers. So I'd invite folks to maybe share a thought, a question. If you can raise your hand or just who's going to start us off? Actually, I think I'll start us off while people collect themselves and get braver. One of the things going to that question, Orla, that you had of Wanda about practices that might have been kind of resurrected or the flesh put on the bones, I was noticing, Wanda, that one of the practices was the wandering. And as it described as here, the weekly time in the natural world for 30 to 60 minutes at a time. And I said to myself, that's a practice of Sabbath keeping, in a sense, you know, saying you must commit to doing this to be part of this processing group. And I just, I remember it made me think back to a Jewish religious educator who once spoke to me about a Jewish conception of Sabbath isn't necessarily that God needs it, but we need to be reminded that we're not in charge by not being responsible for anything. So that you see over the course of the day that the sun rises and the sun sets without you having done anything. Okay. And so this practice of 30 to 60 minutes to me looked like that kind of Sabbath keeping in a sense.
Interesting. Yeah. I particularly hadn't thought about it that way, which is, I think, a little sad given how much work I've been doing on Sabbath with the congregations I'm working with in Creative Callings right now. Oh, well, thank you for making that connection, Teresa. But I think there is that sense. So the one thing, and I had communicated this, Orla and I've been doing a little communicating back and forth. The guides of the Seminary of the Wild process were like, if you do nothing else, you do the wandering. Mm-hmm. If you don't have enough, don't worry about the readings. Don't worry about, you do the wandering. So the fact that that was such a foundational practice of, yes, putting ourselves in our places, so to speak, is what wandering invites us to, getting ourselves out of the center of the story and into communication with the wider world was integral to that. So thanks for naming that.
Jennifer, I see you have your hand up.
I just love this. So I would say the analogy to that, or at least one of the analogies to that in the deep time frame is what I would call going to the deep time place, the deep time place, which is it's a different state of mind from your day-to-day normal state of mind. It's where you let go entirely of everything you have to do. And you just really let yourself sink into the reality of the universe and this larger thing, you know, larger cosmos that we're part of. And I have, because I've done so many programs with children and with people of all ages do this when they're given a chance. And that's often through storytelling, through the storytelling. Where they sit and they listen, I can see it in their eyes, where they go to this, they go to a different place. And it feels similar to what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Kind of Sabbath.
Yeah. It's become so much not a part of our practice. Tiffany writes in the comments, I appreciate the connection between the two, nature as guide and therapist and nature as teacher. It's quite inspiring about nature as support system available to my family and me, even as I seek other supports for a neurodiverse child. The papers have me reflecting on how I can apply these ideas to this, of this to his needs in daily life.
Mm.
Yeah, and Dory supports that, thank you. John.
So this maybe is a question kind of from a different direction. Just 2 weeks ago, the British and Irish Association of Practical Theology had its annual conference in the UK. The topic was money. And there were several people that talked about this, and I gave a paper on kind of economic conversion, converting our frameworks or our point of views on the way that the economy works. It sounds like it's very different from the kind of conversion that you guys are talking about. I mean, is there like your first thought, like, is it quite different to think about different ways of organizing our economy? Is there a path from what you're talking about to that or what? I don't know.
Was your conference on, you know, was it about divestment and that kind of a thing, or?
It was about, there were various things. The thing that I talked about was, like, there are stories that we are told about the way that our economy works and the way that our economy developed. Mm-hmm. But very often those stories are just wrong. And like, it would be very useful to have different, more accurate stories about how credit developed, how loans developed, how debt developed, how those things are actually they develop historically in a much more connected context. And our modern Western context is very disconnected, where I make you a loan or you buy something from me and then we're done. We're not connected anymore. But for like thousands of years, human beings would trade with each other and not say goodbye to each other because they lived in the same village. Mm-hmm. So like there were continuing connections among people, even though as they were trading with each other, let's say. So it was, from my point of view, it was like the big picture of the way that we imagine economies work. My paper was about debt relief, debt forgiveness. Is it really inconceivable? Actually, no, it happened all the time in ancient times. Mm-hmm. But to imagine that you're going to cancel everybody's credit card debt, like people's heads will blow up, right? So I don't know. That's a very unformed question.
Well, what I heard your question about metanoia or conversion in your in relation to the economic system, and that you're presenting other ways of being economical, and so the cosmology that practices economics now is from that extraction model, and right. So if that cosmology is change, that metanoia, then automatically the behavior changes. It's on the vision.
Yeah, maybe not, right? Like there's mm-hmm. a difference between behaviors and ideas. So like we can also have a change of our basic concept, but then like there must be ways to connect that with the way that I deal with my credit card every month. It doesn't automatically mm-hmm. change, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And yep. Dory is saying in the chat that this conversation has been bubbling up about the economics. Mm. So just how can we imagine regenerative economies that provide alternatives? And she's asking if you can put the link in for the Certainly. Conference that you mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Right. So I would love, this is a great point you're bringing up, John. And yeah. I'm just thinking, looking at it in terms of Thomas Berry's three governing themes, which Orla mm-hmm. brought up, which is differentiation, interiority, and communion.
Mm-hmm.
So we can use that for, you know, making decisions about going forward mm-hmm. in different areas or policy issues and so on. So is what we want to do increasing differentiation, increasing communion, increasing interiority? So looking at economics, how is what we're doing rearranging the rate relationships in a way mm-hmm. that is positive for our interiority mm-hmm. and increases the communion? So like what you were talking about, you know, you have this relationship and then it's done. Well, how about, you know, the matrix or communion? We use matrix often, the word, but communion. How do we increase that communion? What are mm-hmm. ways to increase that communion? You know, and if we use those principles, even in economics, it's helpful as a guide. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But then, of course, the challenge, as you're saying, is the practicality. You know, right. What does that actually look like on mm-hmm. the ground? Mm-hmm. So that's the creativity. That's where the, you know, we can be, where we're the co-creatives.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you, John, for putting the link. Maureen, why don't you take the floor?
Hi. Thanks. Thanks to all of you. Wonderful presentations. And I wanted to raise, I guess, to hear from any or all of you about a thread that seemed to come forward to me. I guess I would name it in all of the presentations of kind of long-term and depth reflection and the ongoing nature of transformation that's called for. I've been thinking a lot about ecological conversion, and Wanda was naming, I think, in her presentation that the seminary in the wild, this is not a quick fix, this is something that takes time, and then Orla's deep time, and the Jennifer's the, you know, the sense of participating in this cosmos and this cosmological journey that goes on and on and on. And so I'm wondering how that's, if you will, balanced with urgency and the precarity of our present situation. So how do we reflect and live in this time in which, as thinkers like Bill McKibben and many others, of course, and the wisdom of science tell us, we're in the critical years. We're in this time in which we've got, it seems, relatively few years, if you will, you know, to work with the climate emergency that we have. So how do your approaches, how do you work with reflectively, you know, the both and of a long-term participation and reflectiveness with urgency and the fragility of our present situation? Thanks.
Well, I guess I would speak that the, at least in terms of how it's conceived through the Seminary of the Wild program, is that actually that long-term formation is what sustains the action, not only the long-term slower action, but also just the ability to be engaged in some of these more immediate crises in a way that you are sustained and grounded. It's a both and proposition. And at the same time, I mean, there's this interesting, you know, tension, I guess I would say, of sometimes that sense of urgency feeling very disempowering, like we can't do anything. So people need these opportunities to be told that they can kind of slow down, ground, do the best you can each day. So I don't know if I'm really answering your question, but I think it's a both and. I think the long-term, it is a long-term formation, but that doesn't exclude the opportunity for more urgent responses to the crises we're facing.
Thank you, Wanda.
Yeah, I would just jump in and totally agree with Wanda that, you know, first we have to know what we're part of and, you know, have a sense of what's the cosmic scripture, what's the earth scripture. And that's going to help us focus on the most important things. And it also gives us a sense that, you know, this isn't only going to be us that's going to make it happen. You know, it depends on so many other people and on Earth and the cosmos You know, it's not one person who's going to solve it. There are bigger energy forces at work. And this is totally a religious stance. You know, it's the, what is the religious affect? The religious affect, right, is to be oriented to what we're part of, the vast energetic forces that we're part of. And then we can be so much more effective and we don't get burned out, you know, so we need to have that big perspective. It's both and for sure. Yeah.
That's because sometimes there's the way in which that urgency or it's all up to me just feeds into our own Western individualistic perspective, like
exactly
not recognizing the other forces, both human, more than human, at work in the universe that are also seeking healing and transformation.
And, you know, I love Orla's thing with the understanding and practice, you know, that two-sided coin, I think is such a, I keep that image in the back of my mind. If I'm just doing the practice without really having a deep understanding, it's not going to work. Mm-hmm. Not going to work. So really keeping those two together is just crucial.
And then hope, you know, the hope is a sustainer, and you just do what you know is the right thing to do. And you might necessarily see the result of it, but we know, you know, the choice is based on a sense of interconnection, is the religious thing to do, because religion, religare, you know, we're recognizing now the interconnection of everything. And so actions that we take based on that, you know, is a hopeful way to proceed.
Mm-hmm. I guess one more thing is we don't always understand. We don't always understand. And sometimes you do have to jump and do something, right?
Right. And sometimes you might be a Cartesian again.
Yeah.
Have a memory lapse.
I'm struck for myself reading both of these papers. One of the things that struck me about the process is the need to decenter, you know, and that is when I think about transformative education, it's always that move to what I thought was the world is now different than what I thought. And I have been shifted off of, I'm being pushed off of where I thought I was in relation to the known. Wow. And so to assist people in that process of decentering, where there's necessarily people get distressed in it because it's disorienting at first. Mm-hmm. Isn't a once and done. It's one of the things they've come to appreciate is the more you grow is that this is a lifelong process of kind of getting pushed out of what you think the world is. And mm-hmm. The religious educators were a part of that process and probably in a very intentional sort of way. So we are closing in on the end of our time together. Any final thoughts, praise? Got a few comments in the chat as well as links that are helpful. Anyone else want to offer something? Yeah. Well, I am very grateful to Jennifer, Wanda, and Orla for their work, both what they have offered us today and the work they have been about. I think it's tremendous examples of how we help people both understand more deeply as well as align mm-hmm. their practices with that understanding and vice versa. So tremendous applause all around. Yay, yay, yay. Thank you all. Great to see so many lovely faces. Thank you.
Thank you, Teresa.
You're welcome.
Thank you,
everyone.